Well, good morning. How's everybody doing today? Good, good. Well, some people were telling me welcome back today. We were gone for about 10 days. We went to Illinois for kind of a trip here for a variety of reasons, just to go see our parents. We hadn't seen them for a while, Tom's parents and my parents. And we also went and got a bunch of Davis's stuff. Davis and his two of his college roommates are back here because they're doing school online, and instead of staying in separate rooms wherever, they decided to come and spend the semester here with us in our basement. And so we got the middle apartment down there, so we brought Davis and stuff back with us. So that was kind of our trip there, and enjoyed that, and glad to be able to do that. Welcome people that are watching online. Got to make sure and say hi to you guys. Glad for your worshiping with us there at home. And the rest of the announcements will be at the end. So welcome, and let's stand as we start off with our song of contemplation, the Holy Spirit.
There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. No thing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of love, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, oh. Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, oh. There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. No thing can compare. You're our living hope. Your tasted and seen of the sweetest of love, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, oh. Holy Spirit, you are place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, oh. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. experience the glory of your goodness, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord.
And the Holy Spirit is indeed here, and we welcome him into our hearts and into our lives each and every day as we make our beginning. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us bow our heads as we confess to God. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, but Lord, we come to you. We are, as we become more aware of your presence, Lord, we become more aware of our sinfulness and that we have sinned against you in our thoughts, in our words, in our deeds. We thank you for your love and your grace, but Lord, we are sinners. And we confess to you in a few moments of silence that we are in need of your forgiveness. Lord, thank you for hearing us, for Jesus' sake. Amen. And so I ask you, children of God, do you believe that you're a sinner? Then say yes. And are you sorry for your sin? And do you believe that Jesus can forgive you for your sin? Then I can assure you that your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. With joy, we continue as we sing the song, Here I Am to Worship.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that's made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. So here I am. Together worthy. altogether wonderful to me.
Good morning. And, our Old Testament reading today comes from Ezekiel chapter 33, verses 7 through 9. So you, son of man, I have made a watchman for the house of Israel. Whatever you hear, whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you shall give them warning from me. If I say to the wicked, O wicked one, you shall surely die, and you do not speak to warn the wicked to turn from his way, that wicked person shall die in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at your hand. But if you warn the wicked to turn from his way, and he does not turn from his way, that person shall die in his iniquity, but you will have delivered your soul. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our second reading today comes from Romans chapter 13, verses 1 through 10. Let every person be subject to the governing authority, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is an authority? Then do what is good, and you will receive his approval, for he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the word, the sword in vain, for he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Therefore, one must be in subjection not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. For because of this, you also pay taxes, for the authorities are ministers of God attending to this very thing. Pay to all what is owed to them, taxes to whom taxes are owed, revenue to whom revenue is owed, respect to whom respect is owed, honor to whom honor is owed. Owe no one anything except to love each other, for the ones who loves one another has fulfilled the law. For the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor, therefore love is fulfilling of the law. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the reading of the gospel.
At the time, disciples came to Jesus saying, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" And calling him a child, he put in the midst of them and said, "Truly I say to you, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever humbled himself like a child, like this child, is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Whoever receives one such child in my name receives me. But whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him to have a great millstone fastened around his neck and to be drowned in the depths of the sea. Woe to the world for temptations to sin, for it is necessary that temptations come, but woe to the one by whom the temptation comes. And if your hand or foot causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life crippled or lame than with two hands or two feet to be thrown into the eternal fire. If your eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life with one eye than with two eyes to be thrown into the hell of fire. See that you do not despise the one of these little children. For I tell you that in the heaven, their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven. For the Son of Man came to save the lost. What do you think? If a man has 100 sheep and one of them has gone astray, does he not leave the 99 on the mountains and go in search of the one who went astray? And if he finds it, truly I say to you, he rejoices over it more than over the 99 that never went astray. So is it not the will of my Father who's in heaven that one of these little ones should perish? If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. But if he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If he refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen to even to the church, then let him be to you as a Gentile and tax collector. Truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again, I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am among them. This is the gospel of our Lord, and we continue with our song of the day, Overcome. You may be seated.
Seated above, enthroned in the Father's love, destined to die, poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. He never sinned, he suffered as if he did. All overcame.
You know, there's two topics you're supposed to avoid in at parties and social gatherings. Those two topics are religion and politics, right? We're going to talk about both of those today. How's that? Well, in fact, we have a dual citizenship. You know how some people will have their citizenship in these two different countries or something like that? For us, we definitely have a dualship here on earth, as well as our citizenship in heaven. Jesus prayed in John 17:15, "I do not ask that you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one." So sometimes we kind of wonder, but Lord, just you know, maybe I should just, you know, I kind of like this social distancing. I don't have to interact with people if I don't want to. I can just kind of like stay away and just kind of live in my own world and not have to worry about the problems of the world. But you know, that wasn't Jesus' goal. He didn't want us just to be out of the world, but he wanted us to be kept from the evil one. He wants us to be a salt and light to the world. But what if we live in a country that we don't agree with the government? Well, when Paul wrote these words in Romans chapter 13, he didn't live in a democracy. His government was in an autocracy. An autocracy, the Roman Empire. An autocracy is a system of government which supreme political powers is concentrated in the hands of one person, Caesar. And basically, he wasn't subject to a revote. He wasn't subject to impeachment or anything like that here. In fact, he could order a census of the whole world if he wanted to. And of course, he did, at least one of them did. In Luke chapter 2, we hear these words every Christmas. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. So what is our role with government? Well, verses 1 and 5 of today's epistle reading tells us that we're to be subject to the governing authorities. We're to submit to authorities. Let everyone be subject to the governing authorities, for there's no authority except from God. And those that exist have been instituted by God. So God is the one who gave us our governments. Good or bad, they're there for us. God is sovereign, and all power comes ultimately from him. And if you remember, Jesus talked about this when he was in front of Pilate, about to be crucified. Jesus said, "You would have no authority over me unless it had been given to you from above." Well, verses 3 and 4 talk about the reason for government. Why do we even have government? Why do we need government? Well, Romans 13, 3 to 4 says, "For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who's an authority? Then do what is good, and you'll receive his approval, for he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer." In other words, if you do evil, be afraid. The government is there to protect all of us. You know, if you kill someone else, that's a problem, because in society, that is frowned upon. Government has two priorities here: to protect and to punish. And it's interesting, in verse 6, it says that the authorities are ministers of God. When's the last time you pulled over and got stopped by a cop and thought, "Well, there goes a nice minister of God"? I don't remember ever saying that, but it is a divinely appointed office. Has your pastor ever been pulled over? Yeah. But so have many of you, all right? And every time I do, though, I tell the officer, "Thank you." Because they are doing their divinely appointed work. So next time you get a ticket, thank them for doing their job. But be sure to pray for them as well. As St. Paul says in 1 Timothy 2, he says, "I urge that supplications, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all who are in high positions. That's why we do everything. We pray publicly here for our leaders in our country and, you know, locally, or those that are helping defend us and all that. But, you know, when Jesus came, people thought that he was going to be a political Messiah. They wanted him to take sides against Rome. But Jesus never tried to win a war. He never tried to overturn the tax code. And he never even tried to free the slaves at that time. Did these things break his heart? Yes. Yes, they did. But he didn't come to be a political savior or to change the politics of this world. He came for a spiritual revolution. He came to save people. Because even people in prison, even people who are in slavery, can be spiritually free. What did Paul say in Philippians 1 when he was put in prison? Well, he says, "Now I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel. As a result, it's become clear throughout the whole palace guard and to everyone else that I am in chains for Christ. And because of my chains, most of the brothers and sisters have become confident in the Lord and dare all the more to proclaim the gospel without fear." So in other words, Paul is setting an example to others. Even though he's in chains, he's in prison, he could share that good news with others. And it's true that some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry, but others out of goodwill. The latter also do so out of love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. And the former preach Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, supposing they can stir up trouble for me while I'm in chains. But what does it matter? The important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice. And then Paul says in the verse 21, he says, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. And maybe that's why Jesus says in John 12, whoever loves his life loses it, and whoever hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Because the thing is that God is more concerned about our holiness than our happiness. Not that he doesn't care about our happiness, but he cares more about your holiness. Does this mean that we shouldn't vote and that we shouldn't try and make our government better and we shouldn't run for office? No. No, we should be in the world, but just not of the world. In other words, our faith in God is more important than our politics. Just because two Christians have different political views doesn't mean that one is a Christian and the other is not, or whatever. Don't let politics divide you, especially us Christians. We are all part of the body of Christ. We're going to spend eternity together. And so don't let politics divide you. 1 John 4:4 says, "You, dear children, are from God and have overcome them, because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world." We need to be more concerned about our heavenly home than our earthly home. Even the religious leaders of Jesus' time asked him if it's okay to pay taxes to Caesar. The Pharisees and the Herodians wanted to cause division. They wanted people to hate Jesus for his political views. They wanted Jesus to take political sides. Mark 12 says, "And they sent to him some of the Pharisees and some of the Herodians to trap him in his talk. And they came and said to him, 'Teacher, we know that you're true and do not care about anyone's opinion, for you are not swayed by appearances, but truly teach the way of God. Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Should we pay them or should we not?'" They weren't really being very complimentary to Jesus here. They were kind of being sarcastic. If you want to find sarcasm in the Bible, this is a good place for it here, as they're talking to Jesus. But Jesus, knowing their hypocrisy, said to them, "Why put me to the test? bring me a denarius and let me look at it. And they brought him one. And he said to them, whose likeness and inscription is on here? They said, Caesar's. And then Jesus said, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. And they marveled at him. You see, God is honored when his representatives are good citizens. There was a man one time with a guilty conscience, and he had trouble sleeping. And he wrote to the IRS and said, I must confess I misrepresented some of my income last year and cheated on my taxes. Enclosed is $150. If I still can't sleep, I'll send you the rest. Yeah, sometimes we just want to ease our conscience just enough to make us feel good. But what if I don't agree with the government? What if I don't agree with the way they're spending my money? Is there ever a time for civil disobedience? Well, if you lived in Germany in the 1940s, you may have heard about Dietrich Bonhoeffer. You've probably heard about him today, too. He was a Lutheran pastor and theologian that was known for his vocal opposition to Hitler's killing. But in 1943, it hanged 2 years later, just as the Nazi regime was collapsing. Here's the rule. We submit to government up to the point of God. Okay, because if our government is asking us to disobey God, that's where we draw the line. If it goes against his will, that's where we stop. One example of disobedience in the Bible here is Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They refused to worship the golden image of their ruler. They were put into the fiery furnace, but God spared them. Daniel in the Bible, his government made a decree that no one was to pray to God for a month. But he did it anyway. He even opened up his windows so people could see him. He wasn't afraid. He was thrown into the lion's den, but God spared him. Peter and John in the New Testament were in a city where you weren't supposed to talk about Jesus. They did it anyway, and they got put in jail. And when they were asked, why did you guys do that? Could have just kept quiet and stayed out of jail. They said, we must obey God rather than man. And one more example out of Exodus is where the king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, when you serve as a midwife to the Hebrew women and see them on the birth stool, if it is a son, you shall kill him, but if it is a daughter, she shall live. But the midwives feared God and did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them. They let the male children live. So here's the rule. Citizen of earth until being a good citizen of earth means being a bad citizen of heaven. So basically what we talked about here is that we're to be subject to the governing authorities because God has put them over us, but we should be sure to obey God above all. We should pay what is due in taxes, respect those in positions of authority, but thank God for our citizenship in heaven that we have through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave up his life so we can be free. In Jesus we pray. Amen. Let's stand as we confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed found on our screens and also in the back of our hymnal. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven.
For us men, for our salvation, may God command, who was a bride.
Bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love and the grace that you show us. We thank you for the government that we have and that we can worship you publicly here in this space. Lord, we thank you for all the love and grace that you give us. We pray for all those listening in our bulletin today. We listen for those. We pray for those that have been hospitalized, recovering from surgery. We pray for Leo and Debbie and Jerry. We pray for Mason and Michelle and Josiah. We pray for Drew, Lydia, McKenna, and for Tina and Ron. We also pray for others, Lord, who need our prayers, who have other health concerns. We pray for Debbie and Bob, for Florence and Clarence, for Deb and Duane, for Marianne and Roberta and Becca. Lord, we also pray for others that are listed in our bulletin today, Lord, and we also pray for Pastor Paul Hemingway, who is considering our call to serve here as senior pastor, and we pray that you would bless him and him and his wife, that they may be able to come in 2 weeks and be among us. We also pray for Aaron Biltman, Pastor Aaron Biltman, who has been led by you to accept the call to St. John Lutheran Church in Stryker, Ohio, and that he is announcing that today to his congregation. We pray that you would be with him in this transition and pray for your grace and mercy. Lord, we thank you for all of our church and school and camp and childcare staff at our church and its ministries. We also pray for our missionaries who serve in Indonesia, Spain, and Germany, Alaska, and Mexico. Lord, we also pray for the leaders of our country. We pray for President Trump and our governor and others. We pray for our country as a whole. We also pray for our military, law enforcement, firefighters. We pray for those who do not know God's plan of salvation through Jesus. We pray for persecuted Christians around the world. And we pray for those who have been hurt and who are struggling with COVID-19. We pray for healing for those infected. We pray for protection and strength for medical staff and others at risk. We pray for provision and wise use of necessary space and equipment, and wisdom for leaders at all levels. And Lord, finally, we pray for our military. We pray for those that are listed here, Tucker and Jason and Andrew, Caleb and Matt and Isabel, Colton, Colin and Levi, Jeffrey, Dylan and Ryan, Bryce, Justin, Mark, Chris, AJ, Larry, Angel and Chris, and many others that we know and we name in our hearts. Lord, we thank you for the grace that you give us through Jesus, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he betrayed, took bread. When given thanks, he broke and gave disciples and said, Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper when he given thanks. He gave them saying, Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament, my blood, which is shed for you. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. You may be seated. We will bring the sacrament to you. Welcome to the table of the Lord.
of sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let a rescue begin. Come find your mercy, oh sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow, heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow, heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. Lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you are. There's hope for the hopeless and all those who stray. Come sit at the table and taste the grace. There's rest for the weary, rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow, heaven can't cure. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face. For the morning, oh sinner, be still. Earth has no sorrow, heaven can heal. Earth has no sorrow, heaven can heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are face, oh wanderer, come home. You're not too far. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you are. Come as you are. As you are.
Now may this body and blood strengthen and preserve you from now into eternity. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you, be gracious to you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. We remain standing as we sing our sending song, There Was Jesus.
Every time I try to make it on my own, every time I try to stand and start to fall, all those lonely roads that I've traveled on, there was Jesus. When the life I built came crashing to the ground, when the friends I have are nowhere to be found, I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now. There was Jesus. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing and the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it. For this man who needs amazing kind of grace, for forgiveness at a price I couldn't pay. I'm not perfect, so I thank God every day. There was Jesus. In the waiting, in the searching, in the healing and the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it, there was Jesus on the mountain, in the valley. In the shadows of the alley, in the fire, in the flood, always is and always was. No, I'll never walk in the waiting, in the searching, in the healing and the hurting, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been and where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it, there was Jesus. There was Jesus.
Amen. You may be seated for a few moments here. A couple announcements here that I want to share with you guys here. Dinner by the Dock is next Sunday night. Okay, it's going to be online. Hopefully all of you guys can be a part of that. Otherwise, we'll find some way of sharing that with you here some way. But basically, it'll be at 6 o'clock Sunday night. All you have to do is just go to our website, trinitylutherancamp.org, and there'll be instructions there with a link on how to join in with the Zoom call. You'll see faces and people from, hopefully from all over the state and even out of state that'll be joining us for that. And we'll just kind of give some updates and see and explain what God's been doing at the camp and how your support can help change lives. In 2 weeks, on a Saturday, is September 19th, is our neighborhood barbecue. And there'll be free food, fun games, and live music. And we got a $2,500 grant to cover this. And so there'll be some good food. The games, where we're bringing in those like a miniature golf game and some other games. And live music. We will have the Flathead Valley Airs are going to be singing for us there. John Thorne will be singing there, some of his songs there, as well as one of our praise teams, Barnabas Effect, will be playing as well. So, but the main purpose is not just to have fun, but to get to know our neighbors. We have 300 homes of neighbors that are within just a few blocks of our church. If you go from Highway 93 to Highway 2 to Meridian Road, it makes a little triangle. I call it our Trinity Triangle, because this is like, there's only two churches in this whole area, in this triangle, and we're one of those two churches. And so I want this to kind of be like our neighbors, our friends. We want to get to know them. And so how are they going to find out if we don't tell them? So we need to go invite them. So next Sunday then, after church, as you leave church, you're going to get, I'm hoping for at least 20 families to volunteer to take a little packet with like 15 invitations. with a little map saying, here's your street, go to these 15 homes, and knock on the door. If they're there, great. You can wear your mask and invite them. If they're not there, you just leave the brochure on the door, and that's another way to help get them informed. But we want all of our neighbors to find out and share God's love with them. In 2 weeks begins our new member classes, and so that'll be on the 20th. And so if you know of somebody that wants to join our church, or somebody just has questions, want to know, why do you Lutherans believe this or that about God or the Bible? It's a great place to ask questions and get answers. We'll also be sort of combining this with our Sunday morning, because of our vacancy, we'll be combining this with our Sunday morning confirmation and parents class too. And so it'll be a good chance to cover the same information in kind of interesting format. So starting next Sunday, our schedule changes. 8 o'clock service is still at 8 o'clock, but this service is going to be moved back to our fall schedule here at 10:45. We'll have Sunday school and Bible classes in between, and then people still want to worship outdoors at our camp, and so we're going to have that at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. So if you want to do that, that's a good chance to go be outdoors and still be in worship. And then otherwise, if you want like this big room but not a whole lot of people, then you can worship on Monday nights and at a smaller crowd. But we also have available our website. We'll still have our worship services online as well as DVDs and so forth here.
I'm Colleen St. Pierre. Last week, Pastor Reiner spoke to all of us about Stephen Ministry and what a blessing it is to our congregation. And I'm following up with that message. Recently, one of our caregivers, Stephen Ministers, received a wonderful thank you note from his care receiver expressing his thanks for encouraging him through a very difficult time in his life. He said, thank you for just getting me back on the road to recovery. And for that reason, we as Stephen Ministers want you to know that you're a valuable part of our community, our ministry, and we want to invite you to our next training. We're going to start a new training October 1, and would love for you to be with us. It does make a difference to people in their lives and what they're going through, and we are here to care while God heals. Please join us in this endeavor. Watch your bulletin for further information. Thank you. God's blessings.
Good morning again. It's me. Stephen Minister, everything. But I just want to let you know as a congregation that the Board of Lay Ministry has asked Stephen Ministers to help out with contact to our congregation. And so I just want to let you know that you may be getting, because the elders, we have jobs and we have other things, and sometimes we just don't feel like making calls at the end of the day. So the Stephen Ministers are helping us out. So you may be getting a call from a Stephen Minister saying, hey, I'm Lori Pfeiffer, and I'm here calling on behalf of Randy Avery. And just wanted to see how things are going and things like that. But so Board of Lay Ministry needs the Stephen Minister's help. And, you know, sometimes that's not even enough. It's not enough to have Stephen Ministers help us. And there's times when I can use the congregation for helping as well. And today is one of those days. One of those days. And you know what? Today we have to sing happy birthday to Pastor Kevin for doing an awesome job. And that's where I need your help. John, hit it. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Let's try that again. Come on
okay,
now.
Here we go.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Pastor. Happy birthday to you. God's blessings to you.
Come on, Davis, sing.
God's blessings, dear pastor. God's blessings to you.
Pastor, thank you very much for everything, and happy birthday.
Oh, thank
God's
you.
Blessings to you today.
That's probably the first time I've almost cried when somebody started singing happy birthday to me. And you can take that whichever way you want to take it. All right. And I'm just happy to celebrate my 25th year of being 30. It's really great. So anyway, last announcement then is that before you go, be sure and fill out the attendance card. We're starting to collect the attendance now here. If you don't have a pen or pencil with you here, you can fill it out at home and drop it off later in the week. Or you can fill it out online. Those of you that are watching from home can fill it out at trinitykalispell.org/attendance. Have a great day in the Lord.